Welcome back to Mandaria Legends. I'm your host, Michael Stone. I'm excited to announce that awareness of this podcast is continuing to jump even higher. For example, our Facebook page has reached over 800% more people in the past month, thanks largely to you, our wonderful audience members. And if you haven't stopped by yet, you can find me as author Michael Stone on Facebook, at Mundaria Writer on Instagram, or as Mundaria Legends on Reddit. I'd love to connect with even more of you about books, board games, video games, and more. Now, as a reminder, if you like what we're doing, there are three easy things you can do to help support the show. First, you can like, follow, subscribe, and leave ratings to let others know how much you've enjoyed the story so far. Second, you can become a Mundaria Legends patron on patreon.com and support the production of the show, including the costs of maintaining our website, keeping access to the audio software used to make the show, and more. Just head on to the link in the description for more details. And last, but definitely not least, you can let others who enjoy high epic fantasy know about the podcast. Now, without further ado, we bring to you Episode 8, The Bladetail. Mesiax had never felt more alive. She was the first dragon blade hand. No, the first blade tail in history. Before her lay Stradthryx, a fortress that she had raided time and time again. In the past, Mesiax had to work to keep her distance from the fortress. Draconid pyromancers had the loathsome habit of using a dragon's own fire to scorch their innards. But now, armed with a banishing blade, she had no need to use fire. As she closed in on Stradthryx, she could see that its outer walls and many of the dull crimson stone towers within were pockmarked with blast damage from the volcanic bombardment of the former Blade Hand's stormy assault. The Crucians within were still scattered, disorganized, helping rescue civilians from burning buildings. The thrill of the hunt filled Mesiax as she saw their vulnerability, and then she began channeling the power of the blade. Like other dragons, Mesiax was a wielder of the God Shard of the Wilds, Beloinhu. Let the mermaids and little lizards play with their water and fire, thought Mesiax. For her kind, true power lay in the strength of primal beasts such as she. Her God Shard sigil located on her right foreleg, just as such marks were also found on the back of most other sapients' right hands, began to glow. It was as if the narrow straw through which Mesiax had been channeling her powers before had been replaced by an oncoming river of unrelenting force. She filled herself to the brim with it, feeling the vital, raw energy surge within her as her scales began to thicken, yet not drag her down further. Her bones lengthened, her muscles swelled, and her claws and talons more cruelly curved and arched. With each flap of her growing wings, she grew more massive. Mesiax was soon at least three times her original size. Where once her head was the length of an average human adult's body, it was now the size of a small cabin. And still growing. Unwilling to contain her glee, she let out a triumphant roar. And while some draconids had begun aiming their arrows towards her as she closed in, it was much too little, much too late. She crashed through the outer walls like a new hatchling, frolicking through the underbrush. Rubble and grit were jettisoned into the air, blanketing the city in a fog of destruction and blocking out what little ambient light the late afternoon sun had cast. Panicked screams erupted from within the city as Crucian denizens of Stradthryx saw their winged enemy's shadow emerge from the settling dust cloud. Before they had too much opportunity to react further, however, Mesiax swung her head through some of the surrounding structures, like a heavy mallet through thin sheets of brittle shale rock. More thunderous demolition shook the courtyard in which Mesiax had found herself, accompanied with more terrified screams. For so long, these people had hid inside their walls, feeling so safe, so secure. Mesiax reveled in the havoc as this new harbinger of chaos. But before she could play further, she had a mission to complete. Tzalast. Zeru had let slip that the Archchief's death would mean Mesiax's long-awaited liberation from her slumbering curse. With that pest obliterated, Mesiax would be free to enjoy this new power for not just the rest of the next month, but also have the time to scour the world for every last Crucian. Mesiax studied the tall keep embedded in the mountainous rock face. It was the defining architectural feature of Stradthryx, in addition to its once imposing walls. The keep was a large, thick, tall rectangle of dull crimson stone, with tall arched windows and triangular battlements. One balcony caught Mesiax's attention. Larger and more grandiosely decorated than the others, it seemed the perfect candidate for where the dragon might find the Archchief. Suddenly, an unbidden image flashed across the dragon's eyes as she looked at the balcony. It was as if she was standing on it, and was much, much smaller. She was looking up at an elderly draconid, watching as he showed her the city. Wonder filled her as Mesiax shook the vision from her head. Where had that come from? She had never been in this fortress before. A simmering anger brewed within her as she realized it was likely her own memory problems coming back. Something about this place was making it worse. She had to find that Archchief fast and obliterate her immediately. So, the dragon drew out her claws and began raking the walls of the keep with her talons, beginning with that annoying balcony. She continued to rip through the fortress as she roared out a challenge. Come now, Archchief! Where are you hiding? Come and face your death! She isn't here, winged filth! A proud voice shouted from behind the dragon. She turned her head and saw a scarlet-scaled draconid flying in the air, holding two chain whips, one in each hand. Mesiax spared the warrior a snarl. Zradka, the draconid I have come to know in combat. Still too stupid to know fear, or have you come to die with the so-called honor your kind so slavishly worships? Zradka cracked her whips. You will find that this transformation only makes it easier for me to hit you, prey. Your bones will adorn our walls, and our city will feast on your flesh for days to come. Mesiax grinned malevolently. She would enjoy breaking this one's pride. Brave words, little one, the dragon purred. She lifted her tail, proudly showing the glorious prize of the banishing blade affixed to it, as the sight of it caused even Zradka to unwittingly hesitate. Mesiax cherished the sight of this treasure of treasures, her eyes glinting with a ravenous, murderous intent. But today, I think you will find you are risking more than just your life by getting my attention. The dragon wickedly laughed as she began pursuing Zradka. The draconid began to send volley after volley of molten steel from her whips as she darted around Mesiax. The dragon continued to grin cruelly and began to slash and claw after the pest. Soon, very soon, this one would die too. Payton couldn't be gone. Luella had it wrong, that was all. She didn't know how strong Payton was. So Aeltha continued to fly out towards the medical tents, knowing that Zeru would help him. Payton was just injured. Zeru had helped Luella recover from her battle, so he would be able to help Payton too. Aeltha quickly landed in front of the white tent and began calling,
"Payton! Zeru! Where are you?"
The soldiers and healers nearby jumped a little. They were likely mindful of what had happened when the avian had last visited one of Aglum's tents, but Aeltha did not have the time to care.
"Payton! Payton, where are you?"
Any moment, she would see him. He would be lying on a table, maybe a little battered, but he would be alive, and everything would be fine.
"Lady Aeltha, please come with me."
The familiar, wizened voice caught Aeltha's attention. And sure enough, as she turned to her right, Zeru was there. He was as calm and serene as ever. Hope thrummed in Aeltha, assuring her that what Luella had said must have been a false alarm. She eagerly walked towards Zeru and went with him as he began guiding her away from the bustle of the medical tents. A dagger of doubt dug at Aeltha.
"Zeru, you don't understand. I need to see him right away."
Zeru shook his head, a solemn expression beginning to cloud his face.
"I know, child. I know. He isn't in the medical tents."
"Then he's healthy, then?"
Aeltha looked around, trying to pick out those brown feathers, those kindly orange eyes.
"Where is he? Can he walk? Why..."
Zeru placed his hand on Aeltha's shoulder, silencing her.
"It is best if you see for yourself, Aeltha."
And as Aeltha saw where they were heading, hope thrilled her once again, with a promise of release from the nightmare Luella had told her. It was the camp's periphery, and a circle of healers were surrounding something or someone.
Payton!
It had to be him. Of course, the attack had only just happened. He would be there, maybe lying on the ground or in a stretcher, but he would be alive and awake, and Aeltha wouldn't be alone. Zeru looked to the healers, and once they were but paces away, he asked them,
"You have it ready?"
They nodded, handing him something bound in leather. Somehow, whatever was in that leather, Aeltha instinctively knew it was wrong.
"I don't see the point of this," complained Aeltha. "I want to see Payton. Where is he?"
Zeru gently passed the bound leather object to Aeltha wordlessly. He then turned and waved off the other healers.
"You can leave now. I'll take it from here," he mentioned to them.
Aeltha stood there holding the small package. She couldn't open it. She wouldn't.
"I need to see Payton."
Zeru looked somberly into Aeltha's eyes, and then rested his gaze on the package in her hands.
"No, no, you don't understand. I need to see Payton. Where do you have him?"
Zeru closed his eyes as he breathed in slowly.
"Lady Aeltha, I understand
that this is difficult for you to accept." A strong breeze suddenly picked up around them, nearly causing the healer to lose his balance. "No," said Aeltha. "You're wrong. You just haven't tried hard enough yet. Let me see him. You can help him still. You just have to try harder." Zeru steadily peered into Aeltha's eyes and shook his head again. "Why are you shaking your head? All I want to see is Payton. Where is he? Why won't you tell me where he is?" Zeru's lips thinned. "Aeltha, he is dead." "No!" Aeltha shouted. "He is not dead. You just don't have enough experience with avians, that's it. He could still be saved. Just let me look at him. I can help." Zeru's face hardened for a moment as he closed his eyes briefly, collected himself, and again adopted a calmer, more compassionate look.
"He's dead, Aeltha."
"No! Why won't you let me see him? You can't just give up on him like this! By the Dayan, you are a healer!"
Zeru began walking towards Aeltha.
"Aeltha, open that package."
Aeltha refused to break.
"No! Show him to me now!"
A flash of anger finally erupted from Zeru.
"I am! That package is all that is left, Aeltha!"
A sudden microburst exploded around them, and both Aeltha and Zeru fell to the ground. When Aeltha got up, she saw the package had fallen too, and had opened up, exposing its contents. If Aeltha had already lived 1,000 lifetimes, or expected to live another 1,000 lifetimes, she was certain that she would never live through a moment that was as long or as harrowing as that briefest of seconds where she saw what had been bound in the leather. It wasn't even the full talon, but only the broken tip of one. That and two brown feathers. Zeru carefully picked himself up off the earth and walked over to Aeltha as she continued to stare at the package's contents, transfixed, frozen in time. It was as if she wasn't really there. This had to be someone else, a play she was watching, a nightmare, not real. She heard Zeru's voice, close and clear, yet somehow the sight of the package made the healer's tender voice seem eons away.
"I know how painful this must be, Lady Aeltha," Zeru began. "You see, I have taken a particular interest in the funerary customs of cultures all across the world. I therefore know better than most anyone else on this island how important it was to get the squire's remains to you."
"His name was Payton,"
she quietly scolded, still transfixed by what lay on the ground in front of her, weighed down by more than she ever felt she could be rid of, or what she'd want to be ever rid of.
"Of course, my apologies. Payton. My healers did their best to get to his remains quickly, once we had heard the news, to make sure that they were safe. Had there even been the smallest spark of life left, I assure you, I would have done everything in my power to bring him back to you. But, as you can see, there just wasn't much to work with."
Each syllable Zeru uttered stabbed into Aeltha like the blackest ice. Aeltha had not known that anyone could feel such pain so deeply. Yet, at the same time, she craved the pain, clung to it more tightly than anything.
"I hope, Lady Aeltha, that you know it is natural to grieve. Denial is commonly the first great threshold to pass in times like these."
Zeru fell silent for a moment, and then, as he knelt on the ground next to her, he said,
"If you want to talk about how he passed, I can help you there."
Aeltha was surprised she could speak, but found the words escaping her mouth before she could catch them.
"The senator, she just said that he had died, that there was some kind of battle. But who? What could?"
Zeru patted her back.
"Ah, I am so, so sorry, child. It was Mesiax, the one the Maieli refer to as the Tidal Dragon. A hard, nodding ball of something very dark gripped Aeltha's heart.
Zeru continued,
"From a distance, one of my healers reported being somewhat near the site when he saw the whole incident. The dragon and Pathan had been dueling in the air when he managed to successfully knock her down from the sky. He chased the beast to where it had crashed when, apparently, the dragon used a pocket of volcanic fumes to set off an explosion with her fiery breath, knocking him to the ground."
Zeru paused. He looked away from Aeltha for a moment, considering his next words carefully. Aeltha looked up at him, finally breaking out of the trance that had kept her vision consumed by Pathan's scant remains.
"Then what? What happened?"
Zeru shook his head.
I don't know that I should be the one to tell you, Aeltha."
"No, please, I just need to know what happened."
Zeru's face dripped with sorrow.
"Apparently, the dragon had succeeded in grounding Pathan with the explosion. He was unable to leave. You have to understand what that can do to a person, Aeltha. Being utterly, completely alone."
Again, the nodding, twisting hardness inside Aeltha throbbed. It burned. It burned and did not stop.
"Tell me," she pled. "I need to know everything. Then what?"
"He called for you. He wanted your help," Zeru slowly reported. "But you, of course, weren't there. He tried begging the dragon for his life. He begged for mercy."
Zeru paused, perhaps pained by the tale he was relating.
"And he sobbed hopelessly as the dragon consumed him whole. It was worse than Aeltha could have ever imagined. Pathan had died, afraid, alone. And if that was the case, I know that your people value dying bravely. But I also know your people value the truth, even if it means that, well, according to what I know of your people's beliefs,
his soul will never know peace," Aeltha completed. "He is lost. Gone. Forever."
The burning, twisting pain in Aeltha writhed in her.
"I can...
I can never see him again. Speaking those words, feeling the reality of them, made something inside her snap. Where she had once been uncertain, afraid, and hopeless, there sprung something. A dark determination. She startled herself somewhat as she quickly sprung to her feet and wiped the tears from her eyes. "Where is she?" Aeltha asked. Zeru's eyebrows furrowed.
"There will be time for that later. Are you sure you..."
Anger erupted from Aeltha like a wrathful bolt of heaven from an inky black sky.
"Yes, I am sure."
Zeru nodded, and then directed Aeltha's attention to a fortress in the distance, planted against the foot of Mount Rurin.
"Mesiax now lays waste to Stradthryx. She has the banishing blade, and seems to have used it to make herself even more dangerous and powerful than ever before. I am also concerned about, well, what if you lose control of your powers again?"
The burning pain in Aeltha suddenly froze into steely, cold resolve.
"I intend to."
And, without bothering with any further words, Aeltha grabbed Peyton's remains and quickly stuffed them into her pocket. She then stretched her wings out and blasted upwards into the air, and shot towards Stradthryx. The words of the prophecy Aeltha had read just yesterday echoed ominously in her mind. "Glory immortal, a hero remembered she'll be, at the cost of losing her life." The fear she had once felt at those words was now gone. For now, Aeltha could care less what fate had in store for her, as long as somewhere along the line it involved a dead dragon.
"You've got to be joking," King Aglum scoffed. "From where the currents are flowing now, the tidal dragon has single-handedly reversed our sour fortunes in this war and is even now laying waste to Stradthryx. And you want me to stop that?"
Senator Loella again was meeting with King Aglum in a secluded, desolate part of the bay where above them the Maeli ships were docked. Though the last time they had spoken, the senator had left feeling ambivalent at best about what she should do, she was resolved that Aglum's sophistries would not get the better of her this time.
"It's not just your best option, King Aglum. It's your only one," asserted the senator.
Aglum smirked and actually dared a laugh.
"Oh, and I suppose the oh-so-clever Senator Loella, the savior of our people and moral judge of all, is going to educate me as to why."
Senator Loella did not flinch.
"That tactic won't work with me this time, King Aglum. I am long past worrying about my own reputation, and you have far greater problems on the horizon than trying to fluster someone like me."
King Aglum crowed.
"Oh, please do tell. What self-serving, self-righteous sermon have you prepared for me today?"
Loella shook her head.
"I have no sermon for you today, King Aglum. I have asked you here to threaten you."
The king paused, folding his arms as he regarded the senator with derision.
"Talented though you may be as a hydromancer, Loella, forgive me if I don't take any threats you may have for me very seriously."
Loella grimly floated just half a pace closer to the king.
"Just like you haven't taken the threat of this dragon very seriously?"
The king tilted and shook his head in the mocking style of a teacher concerned for a straggling student. Last I checked, it wasn't a Maeli that the dragon killed. This dragon is practically finishing the war for us, Loella.
Yes, and that's the problem you obviously haven't understood yet, King, Loella said. You said it yourself. The whole reason you have been pursuing this war is to unite our people with a new sense of national pride. What, then, might you think will happen when the dragon has finished her slaughter at Stradthryx? Do you honestly believe that letting a monster butcher Stradthryx will gain you any credit in the eyes of your soldiers? What would happen to your precious national pride if you sat back doing nothing while you let a dragon and not your own warriors bring this war to its conclusion? Could you stand forging such a legacy of inaction and cowardice? Are you so blind as to think no other power-hungry noble in our seas wouldn't take the opportunity to challenge you for this kind of oversight?
Aglum hesitated ever so briefly, then countered. And what? You'd have me go and slay the dragon myself, then, would you? Loella swam up directly in front of the king, just finger lengths from his eyes.
Bring your soldiers. Think of it. The Maeli coming to the rescue of our sworn enemies. Not only would this mean the end of the war, an outsized source of leverage at the bargaining table for peace negotiations, but it would give our soldiers a real sense of pride. You want to cement your authority over these peoples? Make them rescuers. And what true king wouldn't rush to the opportunity to be known as Aglum the Dragon Slayer, savior of two nations?
To her credit, Loella saw Aglum blink rapidly, almost tasting the adulation and respect she offered. He turned slowly, until he was completely facing away from the senator, considering. Loella waited, not daring to breathe.
Fine. But only on one condition. You need to find a way to warn Stradthryx of our approach. It will take us time to get to their fortress. The land between us is now a volcanic minefield. Even if we use our hydromancy to cool the stones before us. I am not sure how long it will take for us to safely get our forces there. The risk of them attacking us becomes greater the closer we get to them.
Aglum turned again to face Loella, his face rigid, calculating.
You are the only Maeli with a diplomatic sway for this task. You are also the only one finding inventive ways to infiltrate Stradthryx.
Loella nodded. I have already thought of a way we can do that. Those openings in the rock over there to the west, they've been pumping out boiling hot water ever since we got here. But I think that whatever the Draconids did to flood their lava moat has cut off the supply of heat to those thermal vents. The water is much cooler now. It's more like a pleasant bath than a death trap.
King Aglum smiled a little.
And if they had been heated by lava, there's a good chance it could lead you somewhere much closer to Stradthryx. My scouts had indeed reported that the Draconids had collapsed the entrance to a cavern in order to help block the flow of their moat. That cavern likely still has some lava in it. But with your hydromancy,
I can find a way, Loella eagerly added. Besides, King, the people of Stradthryx may not be merfolk, but they need water like any of the rest of us. If it's not the first vent I try, I am certain another of them will lead somewhere to a water source in the city.
The king slowly nodded.
Very well. It seems you have given this a great deal of thought.
Then he looked squarely into her eyes.
Go,
and give the Draken its word that the Maeli are coming to give them assistance. If you reach them, and they are willing to allow us to come into their city, use your hydromancy to give us a signal. I'll be looking for it. Loella started back towards the thermal vents, before she was stopped by Aglim calling out to her. But I warn you, Senator, if you fail, if you don't reach the Draconids in time, my human runners won't be able to safely traverse this lava field in time to make much of a difference. And once we begin approaching Stradthryx, there's every chance that dragon will instead turn its attention on my forces. And after our invasion of this island, the Draconids may well be tempted to leave us to that creature's whims. We will need their help, as much as they need ours, if we are to slay this beast. Loella nodded. This will work, Your Majesty. King Aglum harumphed. Just because it's the most politically expedient thing for me to do doesn't mean I am going to like it, Senator. And no, I won't be sending any guards with you. Loella gaped in outrage, but before she could argue, Aglum harshly interjected and brusquely told her, If you really are that confident, you can make it to Stradthryx. And if you really think the Draconids can still be reasoned with, there won't be any need for you to take any of my able-bodied officers with you. Besides, those lizards saw you duel that Zradka. They'll think twice before attacking you. Just go quickly and do your job, and let me do mine. And so, Loella was off. Securing Aglum's aid was vital, not only to save the lives of those in Stradthryx, but, having seen Aeltha blast off towards the fortress, meant that hopefully Loella could do something, anything, to bring help to that girl. Thank you so much for listening. Remember to like, subscribe, and leave a rating for us to let us know what you liked in this episode. You can also support us on Patreon.com. Just look for Mundaria Legends or use the link in the description. And remember, one of the simplest, easiest ways you can support us is simply by letting a friend know about the show. Thank you again so much for listening, especially as we just get started. Stay safe, and remember, you can't see the hero if you don't know the monster.